The computing ability of computers gets almost double every 18 months following the Moore's law. This has allowed us to make better and better simulation programs. Even if the development slows down and our civilization survives long enough, one day after 100,000 or 10,000 years or even more, we will have computers enough powerful that can run an entire universe in a simulation. What if any other civilization have already reached that point? Then obviously they will make their simulated universes. And maybe even the beings of simulated universes gets advanced enough to make their own simulated universes. This implies that there are much more simulated universes than the real one. So the probability that we are in one of these is much more than that of being in one of these. This was the simulation argument given by Nick Bostrom in 2003. Our universe follows a certain set of rules, and the universe is an ocean of information. So basically, if we are able to program all those rules and put the information in the initial state, and we have hardware powerful enough to let the simulation run, then we will have our own simulated universe. There are many arguments against this hypothesis. One is that as the universe is expanding, the information in it is increasing at a very high rate. In case the beings of simulated universe create their own simulated universe, then the information will increase at even much higher rate. So a stage will come when the hardware will not be able to support such a rapid rise in information and it will crash. But this is not a very strong argument, as the beings who will simulate the entire universe can definitely take care of rise in data by adding extra hardware and using better data handling algorithms. Since most of our universe is empty, and even 99.9999% of an atom is empty, there may not be as much data as we think. Another argument against simulated universe is irrational numbers. Many important constants are irrational numbers. Take pi for example. It has a sequence of random infinite digits. The problem is you cannot program randomness into the computer because computer follows fixed rules. Even the methods that you think can generate randomness is not actually random. Computer follows certain algorithms or fixed rules to generate randomness, which is not random at all, just difficult to predict for humans. If you know the algorithm, you can calculate the outcomes of randomness. If any such algorithm was used to define the irrational numbers of our universe, then we would have found the algorithm hidden in the randomness of irrational numbers. So if our universe is inside a computer simulation, then how are there irrational numbers? We will come back to this question in a while. But what about us, our consciousness, how it can be a computer program? Mathematician John Horton Conway in 1970 made a mathematical model called the game of life. If you program the game of life into a computer, it behaves like a simulated universe with two-dimensional grid which is infinite in all directions. The rules of this universe is simple. Each square in the grid can be in two states, either alive or dead. Whether a square remains dead or alive depends on the 8 squares surrounding it. If a living square has no living square nearby, it will die because of loneliness. If a living square is surrounded by 4 or more square, it will die because of overcrowding. But if a dead square is surrounded by 3 living square, it becomes alive. These are the rules of this universe, and you can set any initial state you want. Then you can run the simulation. These very simple rules leads to very complex and surprising results. These rules gives rise to different kind of objects and species which can evolve, move, reproduce. The rules itself doesn't have any concept of all these features. But these simple rules can lead to these complex features like movement and reproduction. So it is possible that these simple rules can produce highly complex features like intelligence. Obviously, that might require utilization of trillions of grids, but our brain also have about 100 billion neurons. Our thoughts are a result of permutation and combination of nerve impulses in those neurons, which makes the possible number of thoughts our brain can generate unimaginably huge, which may be giving us illusion of consciousness and free will. When we look at biological beings at fundamental level, all its process look like automation process following fixed set of rules, somewhat similar to game of life. Planck's length is the smallest possible measurable length of our universe. So far, we know that nothing can be smaller than it. This length is unimaginably small, much more smaller than the atom itself. So it might be possible that a three-dimensional grid whose each cube has a side of Planck's length is the grid of our universe, something like the game of life. Planck time is the smallest possible time interval that we can measure in our universe. When we divide Planck's length by Planck's time, we get the speed of light, which is the fastest possible speed in our universe. It may be possible that some very basic rules were defined and the initial state was set and the simulation of our universe was allowed to run, which resulted in highly complex universe that we see today. But what would be the system requirements of a computer which can run the simulation of our universe? The observable universe has a diameter of about this much light years, that is this much meters. Assuming a cube of side 1 Planck length be the most fundamental part of our universe which can store information in two state form like binary, and if we use memory units that we generally use, then 1 cube of side Planck length is 1 bit. If we divide Planck length with the size of our universe, we get the number of cubes, hence the number of bits required as physical memory to run our universe. Let's convert it into terabytes for more convenience. This is the RAM required to run our universe, since the entire universe is running all at once. That's a very large number. Planck time is the smallest time interval possible in our universe, which is this much seconds. By taking reciprocal of it, we get the clock speed of the processor required to run our universe, which is this much gigahertz. Now these numbers are unimaginably huge. There is a very long way to go before we can run a simulation as complex as our universe. But also note that here we have assumed that the computer that is being used follows the same architecture as computers we use today. If some better architecture is developed, then this impossible seeming feat can be achieved more easily. One example is quantum computers, which use better architecture. Coming back to the argument of irrational numbers just might be a logical concept which has no significance in the simulated universe. But how? Well, it will be impossible to program an infinite series of random digits called irrational numbers. But what if the universe is not made with that infinite precision? We have already seen that there might even be quantum of size or smallest possible size and time. So at very fundamental level, things are made up of building blocks and nothing is continuous. Measurement of any quantity will terminate after certain number of digits after decimal. We can measure a quantity up to the precision of fundamental building blocks of that quantity. We can't measure things beyond that accuracy because the universe is not even made with that accuracy. Irrational numbers would have real significance only if all the quantities were continuous with no fundamental building block. For example, if we are measuring certain distance in meters, we can't get more accurate than 35 digits after decimal, because after that we will reach the definite size which will be a rational number. Then we will be measuring the exact number of building blocks of size. So no real size can be an irrational number. The same goes for every physical quantity. So in a simulation universe, irrational number is just a concept with no real significance. These arguments are not strong enough to falsify the claim of simulated universe. Actually, the simulation hypothesis comes under the category of unfalsifiable claims, but that doesn't make it true. The claim that there is a pink unicorn dancing around in your room, which cannot be detected by humans by any means, is also an unfalsifiable claim. These are the claims that cannot be proved or disproved because of their nature. We can never know whether we are in a simulation or not because we are limited to our universe, and that is the reality for us. We cannot detect anything beyond it because beyond it, the science of our universe ends. But some scientists believe that we can actually know if we are in a simulation. If we get scientifically advanced enough to know everything about the laws of the universe, then we will find the computer codes of our universe hidden deep within the fabric of our space-time or matter, if we are inside a simulation. But does it matter, even if we are in a simulation? If I say I am real in this universe, then I am right. But if I say I am real and we are actually inside a simulated universe, then I will be wrong if we take those simulators' universe as a reference, but I will be right if we take our universe as the reference. This simulation is the reality for us. Maybe those beings of simulated universe are observing us, and maybe even they are watching this video. In that case, hello. But there is no evidence so far to support the simulation theory even a little bit. So we have to withhold any judgment or conclusion until any evidence is found. This is the scientific method. But if the simulation theory is correct and those beings simulating our universe decides to stop this simulation, then we will never know. Because as soon as they quit the program, our consciousness will cease to exist.